Shows you have changed your hearts and lives. Welcome to this service of worship. We're glad that you're with us. We have a few things we want to make note for you as we continue in worship throughout the week. You'll find a lot of those community notes at the end of the video, but in this moment, let us together make use of the questions that are before you.
Of the earth. never gonna change the world by standing still. No, we won't stand still. No, we won't stand still. No, we won't stand still. Yeah. If not us, then you. If not me and you. Right now. Well, it's time for us to do something. For us to do something.
The confession is one of the most important parts of the service. In our preparation to receive God's word, we ready ourselves by accepting God's discipline. This makes the prayer of confession more than just a perfunctory exercise. While the corporate prayer is one you didn't write, the silent prayer is. It is the deep breath, the pause, the moment we take to open ourselves to God naming our sins and receiving the grace to do something about them. So take the next 5 minutes. It can be longer than you think. And if you need, pause the video and take longer. But take a deep breath and review the week's activities. Listen for God's voice about what needs to transform within you, and take this opportunity to ask for God's help and insight. Let us begin. Holy God, we readily admit we sin against you. We do. We also know perfectly well that we sin against others. We don't like it when you, or anyone else for that matter, name our sins. When you call us out and make us realize what we need to see, what we need to hear, what we need to know, forgive us for giving lip service to our sinfulness and then doing nothing to address it. Forgive us for presuming in our day-to-day behavior that we're fine the way we are. Help us reach for better. Help us reach for you, Lord. Gratefully, we pray this. Thank you for listening, God. Amen. So there's a ritual that we do after the Sunday evening worship service here at Hawfields. Every Sunday night, after the instruments and the stands and the mics, the AV and other equipment all get put away, there comes the perennial question, where should we go for supper? Now, while our geography makes it easy to choose where we might go, there's still enough variety and strong personal preferences that the Adam and Eve skill of passing the buck is alive and well in us. I mean, you can just hear it, right? Well, where do you want to go? Well, no. Where do you want to go? I don't care. It doesn't matter to me. Well, let's go to Canada. No. Well, didn't we go there last week? Oh, well, I don't like the service there. Oh, okay. Well, where do you want to go? Doesn't matter to me. Well, I don't care either. I mean, you get the idea. You know, it's a funny quirk in our indecisiveness that it's a reflection of a broader instinct in us. Y'all, we don't like to be wrong. Now, we've talked about it before, and let's be honest, we are odd ducks when it comes to coping with our wrongness, our personal wrongness. We'll admit that everyone makes mistakes, even admit the idea that we as individuals are wrong from time to time, but we presume that we're right. We claim to know how we feel, but we can't put it into words. We say we want to be better Christians, but we're loath to change a single habit on the way to holiness. We'll even agree to pray the prayer of confession while steadily maintaining the belief that it really doesn't apply to me personally. It might apply to us as a group, just not to me. We'll readily name the wrongness of someone else's behavior while fluidly rationalizing and excusing the same behavior in ourselves. We are odd ducks, sinful ducks. You know, I remember asking the session the question, if it was clear that some habit or thing that we do as a congregation was racist, would you really want to know? Now, let's just say any answer short of, well, of course, absolutely, demonstrates what we're talking about. We don't like to have our sins named. We don't like it pointed out. And I'm not talking about missing a measurement or forgetting a turn going somewhere or consistently calling your children by the wrong name. Just ask my daughters. I'm talking about the times that we are wrong. The times that we've held on to a position when we should have let go 4 arguments ago. The times when we did something and then hoped nobody would notice. The times that we sat by and wished that we had said something and then chose not to in order to get along. The times that we got into it with someone and constantly thought of what we wanted to say rather than actually listening to the other person and responding to what they're actually saying. The times that we left when we should have stayed. The times that we chose not to look so that we don't have to deal with it. The times when we simply refused to say sorry. Everyone gets it wrong, but we are gifted emotional, spiritual gymnasts when it comes to maintaining that we are right. And sometimes our stubbornness can only be countered by stark, harsh language. Just to get our attention. Just to get us finally listening. Y'all, this is the gospel according to Luke chapter 3, verses 7 through 14. John the Baptist describes holy living. Listen for the word of God to us all. Then John said to the crowds who came to be baptized by him, "You children of snakes, who warned you to escape from the angry judgment that is coming soon? Produce fruit that shows you have changed your hearts and lives. And don't even think about saying to yourselves, 'Abraham is our father.' I tell you that God is able to raise up Abraham's children from these stones. The axe is already at the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree that doesn't produce good fruit will be chopped down and tossed into the fire." The crowds asked him, "What then should we do?" He answered, "Well, whoever has 2 shirts must share with the one who has none, and whoever has food must do the same." Even tax collectors came to be baptized. They said to him, "Teacher, what should we do?" He replied, "Collect no more than you are authorized to collect." Soldiers asked, "Well, what about us? What should we do?" He answered, "Don't cheat or harass anyone, and be satisfied with your pay." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You see, this is where our gospel story brings us. John, it is said, is preparing the way for Jesus' arrival. What that means is something worth many sermons and Bible studies to get into and cover. But for our purposes here, we are just going to stick with John's basic message. Repent and be baptized, or be baptized and show that you're repenting. However you slice it, God is looking for transformation. God is looking to disrupt the status quo, not for a moment, but for all the moments, not just when we're babies or going through confirmation. And listen, while it would have been easy for John's audience to stop listening and presume that he was talking about the Roman occupation, the state of Greek commerce, corruption of the religious leadership, or a host of other issues, the transformation that John was talking about was personal, intensely personal. Now, before we get too far, I do have to ask, since when is name-calling a Christian activity? I mean, seriously, do you think it's okay for John to be calling them children of snakes? And think about how deep that insult goes. Not children of Adam and Eve, but of the snake. The one God specifically said would be at war with God's actual made in God's image children. I mean, it's pretty sure, pretty certain that I couldn't get away with calling you all that now. But it would be a mistake to simply think that John is being mean. John is calling them out. John is naming their sins. The snake reference is not accidental or even all that creative. John is calling them out for the same reason that Adam and Eve got kicked out of the garden. I mean, they aren't children of actual snakes. They are children of the snake's temptation, of Adam and Eve's choice, rebellion against the God who made them and gave them everything. In this way, John should be calling us names also. You know, last week in the story of the prodigal father, it pushed us to actually name our sins, to get into that activity, to at least think about what we've done and its effects. And if John wanted to leave it there, he could have lobbed his insult and walked away, washed his hands of them. Vengeance would have demanded this. But remember, the goal is transformation, repentance, love even. John loves his community. He loves them enough to, one, tell them the truth, and to, two, stick with them. Now, first of all, John tells them the truth about their situation and where their choices have led. I mean, would we be willing to do that? Would we be willing to hear such things from a John the Baptist? Would we be willing to say such things to someone? Now, to be clear, I'm not suggesting that we step out into and immediately start trying to tell other people how to live, or trying to tell them what they're doing is wrong. But I am suggesting that we can claim, we can't claim that we love someone if we're unwilling to tell them the truth, if we're unwilling to say the truth to that same someone. If you see me sinning and choose to stay silent with me about it, you don't love me. If you decide to tell someone else that I'm sinning and not tell me, those are two sins and further demonstration that you don't love me. But telling can get tricky, right? Because when calling someone out on their sins, when do you cross the line into judging? When does name calling cease to be love? As a guide, let us be reminded of God's own caution from Scripture. Revenge is my domain. So is punishment in kind, says the Lord. I mean, as much joy as we might take in comeuppance and schadenfreude, our mission remains to love our neighbor as ourselves. How would we want someone to tell us what we don't want to hear? Now, the second thing is John sticks with them. And it's the real sign that John loves his community. He teaches them. He gives them infinitely practical advice on how to repent, how to transform. And the list he gives is things that people in question can do in the moment. Not after years of practice, but right then and there. And it is a great personalized list, right? Remember, being a child of God is a gift of God. And if you have to, give to those who, if you have, give to those who don't have. And don't be greedy. And don't cheat or be a bully. Learn satisfaction. In other words, if you really love your neighbor as yourself, how would they be able to tell? Can you imagine a world like this? And if this is the end result, John can call me a snake all he wants. I mean, you'll notice he didn't say anything about Leviticus, Numbers, or Deuteronomy. He didn't say anything about the religious leadership nor the Roman occupation. He wasn't talking about political upheaval, even though what he was advising would do that. He was talking about people taking a close internal look and then acting from within their power, their God-given power. Following God's path isn't hard because it requires something that we don't have or capabilities that elude us. God's requirements are within reach. So why do we have such a hard time getting on board? I mentioned before, we're odd ducks. Because the whole time that we act as though we're right all the time, we beat ourselves up because we know that we're not. We can prove unkind to ourselves. We hold ourselves to standards that the original manufacturer doesn't specify. And as we contort ourselves into these impossible philosophical knots, God lends further advice to us on how to make this transition, this transformation that John is calling for, that Jesus died for, that the Holy Spirit empowers us to achieve. This is the letter to the Colossian church, chapter 3, verses 12 through 17, the path to a holy life. Listen further, for God's word to us all. Therefore, as God's choice, holy and loved, put on compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Be tolerant with each other. And if someone has a complaint against anyone, forgive each other. As the Lord forgave you, so also forgive each other. And over all these things, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity. The peace of Christ must control your hearts, a peace into which you were called in one body. And be thankful people. The word of Christ must live in you richly. Teach and warn each other with all wisdom by singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Sing to God with gratitude in your hearts. Whatever you do, whether in speech or action, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, and give thanks to God the Father through him. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You know, this passage in Colossians starts with the single most important fact of our existence. God chose us. I mean, this is amazing and would be amazing and great brand new news to us, except for the idea is ancient. It's old school love at its finest. We are God's choice. Now, settle in though and consider what this means. I mean, in our worst moments, our worst children of snakes moments, we are God's choice. I didn't secretly pass some test or meet some demand. I wasn't more holy in my living than you or anyone else. I didn't perform some heroic or salvific act, and then wham, I'm in the club or in the family. God chose me. God chooses you. God chooses us. One of the true failings of the Israelites over the entirety of the biblical text is that they would forget this fundamental fact. And I got to tell you, we forget this also. Whenever we're complaining about someone else's behavior, the state of our world or politics, where our church is compared to back in the day or to other churches, when we rise to the creaking of bones or the ache of years, when we look around at our toys and it isn't enough, when we wonder why things won't change or how awful some people, some situations, some things can be, when we forget that we are chosen, even though it's the impetus for everything that God demands of us. Think about our present historical moment, okay? Imagine if the 118th Congress, if all the members remembered that they were chosen, not entitled. Imagine if warring neighbors remembered that they were chosen, not destined. Imagine if couples remembered that they were chosen, not deserving. If friends remembered that they were chosen and not take each other for granted. Imagine if the church remembered, if we remembered we were chosen. It only adds urgency, right, to the list that the writer of Colossians puts forward. It's good practical advice for Christian teachers, Christian counselors, Christian spouses, Christian oil rig workers, Christian scientists, Christian bankers, Christian housekeepers, Christian homemakers, Christian parents, Christian floor installers, Christian soldiers, Christian tax collectors, Christian leaders, Christian churches. Well, Christians. I mean, the list that God puts forward is good on any human level. Okay? Any tribe, any race, creed, nationality, political class, economic status, family background, anyone can do what God wants. Anyone. At any time. Okay, so why don't we? Well, y'all, it really does begin with us, with each of us, confessing and repenting. Because confession opens doors to possibilities that refuse to remain dreams. A world transformed, each of us, every one of us, changed into the people that God meant for us to be. So look, let's call each other out. Let's do that. Let's just be sure to also remember that we are all chosen, that we are all called to change, and we all can change. God is not nearly as far. God's requirements, God's list, is not nearly as far from us as we thought. Thanks be to God. Amen. We give not from obligation or even coercion by God or anyone else. We give as an ongoing expression of our faith. We give because we acknowledge God has blessed us and because God seeks most for us to actually be blessings. And so we don't give because we have. We give because we can, as we can, in response to an unfailing grace of God toward us and toward all. As we consider the blessings that we've received and the blessings that we've been this week, let us ask for God's grace on what has been given. Let us pray together. Creator God, please continue to make us all blessings according to your purpose. May we not simply be recipients of your gifts, but conduits of your grace. Thank you for your trust, O Lord. Teach us to live trustworthy. Bless what has been given, including us, we pray. In the great name of Jesus Christ. Amen. As we pray together, there'll be an opportunity for you to include your personal prayers. In that space, when the time comes, take advantage of that space. If you need to pause the video, but in any case, Let us pray together. The Lord be with you and also with you. Let us pray. Holy God, why do you even deal with us? What is it you see in us to choose us despite what odd ducks we can be? Despite the messes we make of things? Lord, we know it matters what we've done, where we've been, and what we've chosen. But we also know it matters more where you want us to go, what you want us to do, and that you choose us. You choose us. All we can say, great God, is thank you. So thank you for calling us names. Thank you for calling us out on our sins. Help us listen. Thank you for giving us such an accessible path to living the way you want. Help us follow. Thank you for loving us so completely. Lord, have mercy. Help us do the same. Thus, in the face of the ongoing wars and conflicts, the storms, the health crises, the challenges that we face right here around us and within us, let it all not be so utterly discouraging and disheartening. Help us instead lean into your Spirit, guiding and propping and correcting. And as we live into this, Lord, help us to again be the people of your dreams. In this way, we do pray for so many in our community who are sick and shut in and in rehab. We pray for those among us who've lost loved ones even this week. And we think of those in our public and private prayer lists. Lord, intervene as only your mercies can, and help us to not only reach for your hand for ourselves, O God, help us be your hands, your feet, your mouth, your ears, your presence. Hear us now as we lift our personal prayers. Thank you for believing in us. Thank you for transforming us. Thank you for teaching us even how to pray when words fail us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. Amen. Let us together say our benediction. So let us call each other out. Let's just be sure to also remember we are all chosen, we are all called to change, and we all can change. God's list is not nearly as far from us as we thought. Thanks be to God. Get up and take heart. Jesus is still calling you. And as you go, may the peace of Christ, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and minds this weekend and all the moments to follow and forevermore. Amen. Blessed Jesus, you have loved us, love us still. Blessed Jesus, you have loved us still. So sometimes we look at people we admire and we wonder, how could we ever be like that? Well, God calls us holy and children of God now, as we are. That's not an excuse to let everything go, so to speak. and to take that for granted. But it should encourage us that God wants for us, that what God wants for us is within reach. So when we face each day this week and the weeks to follow, let us claim our God-given heritage and live into the holy life given to us. That means we are on firm ground when we apologize because God has already claimed us. It's just that God is still working on us. You see, the goal is not perfection. It's perfect love working in us. So get working. Also, the spiritual discipline of confession teaches us to be mindful of our own shortcomings and to be dissatisfied with our status quo while bearing out patience and compassion for those struggling around us. Everywhere we turn in Scripture points to this goal of God to transform us into holy people, folks set aside to chase after God's dream of divine community. And so, as we progress through the series, let us take seriously the opportunities for self-examination, invite unbridled honesty, breathe in uncompromising courage, and breathe out realizations of love. Let us look forward to a difficult but worthy journey together. And this includes updates to all the study materials in the Follow Me series. There are several ways to get connected with the resources for the study in addition to the worship services. And for more information, you can reach out to our church educator, Mandy Ely. Finally, we do want to make sure that you remember that as ordered by our bylaws and by Prudence itself, we will have our annual meeting this weekend on January the 29th at 2 o'clock p.m. in the sanctuary. There, we will officially receive the 2002 annual report, reflect on 2023 and upcoming events trends, as well as taking up the session's motion to approve the pastor's terms of call. Let us together participate and with one voice discern God's will. And thanks.